What's up, guys? Awesome Nurcho here, back again with Highlight of Monday Night, our weekly episode on Mondays featuring the WWF Raw versus WCW Nitro, both that fought each other back in the late 90s for supremacy of ratings and stuff in the wrestling world. And so we're going back again, starting with 1997, if you haven't seen this before. And of course, we'll go through Raw and then Nitro, just going through all the matches and everything. And then kind of seeing which one was better, even though I don't rate them or anything because I don't know how to. But just giving you like what happens and let you decide for yourself. So we're going to start with Raw. And of course, this took place on January 20th, 1997, as both of these will. And Raw took place in Beaumont, Texas. Now, this is the night after the 97 Royal Rumble, which again, we're coming up on the anniversary of it next weekend with this year's Royal Rumble. And so it's the big, huge spectacular in the Alamo Dome in San Antonio and stuff. So this is the night after. So we have the fallout from the Royal Rumble. And so with that being, or with that happening, it kind of sets up the stuff that's going on Raw and stuff. So of course, if you don't know, at the Royal Rumble, Shawn Michaels wins the title from Sid, and so in his hometown, big homecoming and stuff like that. And then Stone Cold wins the Royal Rumble after being eliminated by Bret Hart, but without any of the refs seeing him, so he sneaks back in and starts eliminating other people and ends up winning. So that kind of is the two big things going on right now. So we open up the show with Vince, JR, and Jerry the King Lawler all standing at ringside, and Bret comes walking out to the ring to confront Vince with the unfairness of what happened at the Royal Rumble. And he said that before this, back in 96, Bret had taken a break after the Royal Rumble or the WrestleMania 12. He took a break and like went and did acting and stuff like that. Well, he came back late last year, I think probably Survivor Series-ish or the December pay-per-view. And he said that, you know, when I resigned, you promised me that I would get a title opportunity. And he had that in the December pay-per-view, I believe. But he lost that because Shawn Michaels was being like a guest commentator during the match, and Shawn had got in the ring and interfered, so Bret lost that. So he feels he didn't get a true title opportunity, and then that he deserved to win the Royal Rumble because he was the last person technically left before Stone Cold eliminated him, which he had already eliminated Stone Cold, so you know, that's that he got screwed and everything, so he deserves another title shot. And then he complains how he's been screwed by now Shawn Michaels, Stone Cold, the WWF, and Vince himself. And if he doesn't get the opportunity he wants, he's going to quit. And then he gets out of the ring and walks out through the crowd. So as soon as he starts walking out through the crowd, Stone Cold comes down and gets into the ring and starts, you know, cutting a promo and stuff like that, but the microphone he has isn't working, so he gets another one and, of course, complains about having a working mic, and then he calls out Bret, you know, saying he's a whiner and stuff like that, and tells him to go back to Canada, and then he's talking about how, announcer, so JR, someone is saying how he's Stone Cold's supposed to have a match tonight for the main event against Sid, but Sid is, I think they said he's like out sick or something, but it like when I was looking stuff up, it said that he had a concussion or something, so that's why he wasn't there, and then instead he would have a match with the Undertaker. And so he's standing in the ring like getting ready, you know, for a match, even though it's not happening yet. But so Vince just goes walking around the ring and then back through the entrance and stuff. So he just leaves and stuff. And then so, of course, commercial will come back and we have our first match of the night, which is Owen Hart and British Bulldog with their manager Clarence Mason against Furnace and LaFon, which again are two, like, I think they were like New Japan or some sort of like famous Japanese wrestlers and stuff like that. Of course, they're not from there, but that's where they became famous and stuff. So again, it's just in the match. Owen at one point has a nasty drop kick as Bulldog is in the ring, and he goes to like slingshot Furnace into the ropes. And as Furnace is coming back, Bulldog, you know, does the drop down, And so he jumps over him, but as he's jumping, he like pretty much trips over him. And then Owen at that point had climbed up to the top rope. And so as soon as he jump gets over Bulldog, Owen does a drop kick from the top rope. And so with him tripping over Bulldog at the same time, he's also already falling. And then Owen drop kicks him. And so it's a really nasty move that goes on there and stuff. But JR reads a, this is one funny part. So if you don't remember last week, during the Nitro part, we I talked about at the very end during the main event of Hulk Hogan and the Giant, they kept advertising stuff for the Robin Hood show, and that the match would break in between the commercials for Robin Hood and stuff like that. And so now on this night, JR makes comments. He's reading a commercial because they would always read like little commercial things for the shows afterwards, and he read for a show called La Femme Nikita. And he says that, and I guarantee you Nikita is much stronger than that wimpy Robin Hood and stuff. And so he's taking shots, of course, at WCW. There's a lot of course throughout the match. So back to actual match. So throughout the matches, of course, a lot of double team between Bulldog and Owen. And then Owen ends up hitting LaFon like through a distraction. So Owen grabs the slammy. And he's of course on the ground outside the ring, and then just takes it and slams the bottom of it into LaFon's head. And Bulldog then picks him up and does his running power slam for the win. And so that's our first match. And then we go to a replay of like Shawn coming out for the Royal Rumble from the night before, of course getting the hometown reaction. And then we have their second match of the Nation of Domination coming out, which it's going to be Farouk versus Bart Gunn, of course, of the Smoking Guns. And JR makes a comment on the main event of Stone Cold and Undertaker, which was announced instead of Sid, and says that you won't have to sit through that Robin Hood show to see it and everything. So again, taking another shot at WCW. And so throughout this match, Farouk dominates most of it, of course, as you'd expect, the giant beast, you know, Farouk against just the, I'd say the second member of the Smoking Guns, because he definitely wasn't Billy Gunn. At one point in the match, Bart gets the upper hand finally, and he goes to pin Farouk, and the Nation of Domination members outside the ring start like taunting him and stuff, and so or like in the interference stuff. So Bart gets out of the ring and starts to like go after him, but of course the mass numbers of the Nation of Domination ends up overtaking him, and he gets beat. And Farouk, so they beat him up and throw him back in, and Farouk wins with his move called the Dominator. I don't know exactly what it is. It's just his whatever his move is. And so then we that ring or that ring that match ends, and so they leave. And then Vince and Gorilla Monsoon, which is the president or something at this point in time, comes walking out to the ring to talk about, you know, the events of the Royal Rumble. And so he says that in the WWF, the ref decision is final. So makings are pretty much, I guess, guaranteeing or solidifying that Stone Cold did win the Royal Rumble. So that decision stands. And that there is going to be a four-way match between The Undertaker, Stone Cold, Bret Hart, and Vader, since they were the last four of the Royal Rumble. And so they're going to compete in a four-way match, and whoever wins will get the title shot at WrestleMania 13. Excuse me. Then Stone Cold walks out saying that he deserves that match because he won the Royal Rumble fair and square, and then threatens to beat up Monsoon and stuff. And then Bret comes out to return, or returns back through the crowd, and accepts to be in that match, which of course makes Stone Cold mad. And then Bret and Austin start fighting, and then they're like fighting outside the ring and stuff. Well, Stone Cold returns to the ring to get ready for the match, because it's getting ready for the main event or whatever. And so, like, officials and stuff are holding Bret back and everything from getting in the ring. And so now we're going to the Stone Cold versus Undertaker match. And so as Undertaker comes walking out, they're, the officials are taking Bret to the back. Well, Undertaker starts attacking Bret, or Bret attacks Undertaker, one of the two and stuff. So they start fighting. And then, so they're fighting everything, and Undertaker's like, beating up on Brett and stuff, and the officials again are grabbing hold of Brett and taking him back. So while Undertaker has his back to the ring, Stone Cold comes running out of the ring and starts attacking Undertaker. And so, of course, their match starts and keeps going on, and it breaks for commercial, but right before it goes to that, it goes to a backstage fight where Vader and Brett are now fighting in the back. And then, so then it comes back from commercial. And of course, there's more just fighting, and Stone Cold or Undertaker goes the choke slam Stone Cold. But as he's lifting him up, Vader comes running out from the entrance and attacks the Undertaker. And then soon after that, Bret Hart comes running out too. And then all of course, all hell breaks loose. So they're all fighting each other, and it breaks out to Bret Hart and Stone Cold, and then Vader and Undertaker, since those were the matches or like two big fights that are going on and everything. And so that's pretty much it for Raw. So it's a I guess with the events of the Royal Rumble and announcing the four win stuff, it's a much more like urgent, I would say, like Raw and stuff. There wasn't as much boring stuff. I mean, the matches were kind of slow and boring and stuff, but there was a lot of like outside stuff going on. So now we're going to switch over to WCW Nitro. And of course, this is again January 20th, 1997. And this took place in the United Center in Chicago, Illinois. And I think this is the day after the Super Bowl, maybe. I don't remember exactly at this time. But of course, they start the entrance. And of course, you have the announcers talking and everything. And it's like showing around the arena. Well, you see Macho Man come through the crowd. Jump over the railing, and he grabs a chair, takes a chair, and sits it in the middle of the ring and sits down. And of course, he's wearing all black and white, so he's got the NWO colors on. But it said that he had been blackballed or something. That's what he claimed when he talked and stuff, that he's been blackballed. And they said he hadn't been seen since Halloween Havoc, so October the year before. So it's been, over 2 months probably and stuff, maybe three. But he claims that he's not leaving until he can talk to someone with a little stroke, or with some stroke in the business, and says that Eric Bischoff can kiss his ass and stuff. And then he just sits down in the chair and waits. And so like probably comes to a commercial, then comes back, and it's get ready for the first match, which is Chavo Guerrero versus a guy called Max. And so Chavo comes walking out. And of course, Macho is still sitting in the ring. And so Chavo's like, just standing in front of him, like trying to talk to him and stuff. And Macho's just sitting there. Now, this segment is like really long because it's a lot of just Chavo. Of course, you can't hear anything, but he's trying to like talk Macho Man to get out of the ring so he can have his match and stuff. And Macho Man ends up getting tired of it. And so he's gets up, he hits Chavo a couple times and throws him out of the ring and then sits back down. And then a few seconds later, Max then comes out and tries the same thing, tries to talk Macho Man out and like, what are you doing? And Macho hits him and throws him out of the ring. And then we finally get the ref, that's the official for the match, to try and get Randy out. Again, Randy hits him and throws him out. And then we have Doug Dillinger, which is like a I forget what they said. He's like a wrestling security or wrestler security and stuff, like to take care of the wrestlers and everything. So he comes out, and then there he gets attacked and thrown out. Then there's Alex Wright, same thing. And then I think the like amazing French Canadians come out, and then the Steiners and stuff, but they're all standing on the outside of the ring trying to get Macho Man out. And then finally, there's a lot of commotion, and it looks up, and Sting is rappelling down from the ceiling. Now, I'm not sure if this is the first time he's done that. It's the first time I've seen in any of this stuff or it being shown or anything. And so he comes down from the ceiling and starts walking to the ring with the bat in his hand, like a baseball bat, in case you didn't think an actual bat. And so he gets in the ring, he's just like staring at Macho Man, and he's like walking around in circles, and he's taking the bat and like beating it on the chair legs and stuff like that. And he ends up standing right in front of Macho Man. Then he takes the bat, points it right at him, and like sticks it under his chin. And so because he's like pulling up on it, so Macho Man like stands up and of course has the bat under his chin the whole time. And then Macho Man is like trying to come at him and stuff. And so Sting takes the bat and just keeps like poking him with it, like pushing him backwards and stuff. And then finally, Bat flips, or Bat, Sting flips the bat upside down, hands the handle part to Macho Man. And then Macho Man takes it, and Sting turns around and puts his arms up and just stands there with his back to him, like waiting for him to hit him. And he never does. And so Sting turns his head a little bit side. Of course, Macho Man like tosses the bat forward and Sting catches it. And then they kind of look at each other, and then Sting gets out of the ring, and Macho Man follows him, and Sting goes over to the crowd and climbs over the railing and starts going, and Macho Man follows him along the same way. And of course, they don't really say much of anything, but it's kind of a cool thing that happened. So that's all the very first segment. So that first match never happened. So then we go to what is the official first match, and it's Chris Jericho versus Alex Wright. And again, it's got a very quick match with Chris Jericho winning for with a roll up. We go to match three, which is the fake Sting, so the NWO Sting. And I don't know who the guy is, but I know I looked him up before. But it's just some guy, and he of course wears all black with the NWO shirt, and then has the face or Sting face paint on and stuff. So it's obviously they call him fake Sting. So it goes along with the fake Razor and Diesel that WC or WWF has at the time. And he has a match with Scotty Riggs, of course, or again the second half of the American Males. And so throughout the match, Buff Bagwell ends up walking out in the entrance, trying to distract Scotty again, like he did last week. But Scotty like gets distracted, so he's over at the like ring corner, like looking up at Buff Bagwell. And then Sting or the fake Sting goes to attack, but Scotty like paying attention to it and stuff. So he moves out of the way and is like able to counter it. And so a whole bunch of NWO, what I call the B squad, so pretty much not Hall, Nash, Hogan, or I would probably include Six in there, but they all run to the ring, and Scotty like gets out of the ring and runs away, and he wins by disqualification. But the NWO is in the ring, and they force the ring announcer to say that Sting actually won. So again, the ref said that Scotty won, but the NWO is forcing the ring announcers to say that Sting won. So again, this can go back to the WWF Raw, where it's Gorilla Monsoon said our official what our official say like stands and stuff like that and everything. So it's kind of like, even though I'm pretty sure they were both filmed or done at the same day and stuff, because since it's after Royal Rumble, Raw would be taped either earlier in the day or that night and stuff. So it's like they're done at the same time, so that I doubt it's like a shot at Nitro and stuff, but you never know. So then we have a little segment thing with Ric Flair at the Blackhawks in Chicago with one of their hockey players. I don't know who he was, and I didn't catch the name and stuff. But he's just with him, and they do a little promo thing. And then we go to the match four, which is Arn Anderson and Steve Mongo McMichaels against Eddie Guerrero and Jeff Jarrett. And the crowd goes crazy for when Steve Mongo McMichaels is tagged in, of course, because he's a part of the 85 Bears and stuff like that. And since they're in Chicago, he's celebrated like a hero and everything. But something happens. I assume Six ended up coming out, but the camera never showed it. But the crowd kept looking towards like the entrance and stuff, and you see Eddie like looking over that way, and then he just gets out of the ring and takes off running. But again, you never see until he actually starts running. And then I think it was one of the commentators said something about like I think Six was up there or something. But again, you never see him to know for sure. And so Arn Anderson has Jeff Jarrett and the Boston Crab when Deborah McMichaels gets into the ring and takes off her Miss Illinois sash that she wears, and takes it and throws it at the ref, kind of like a throwing in the towel type thing, giving or trying to save Jeff Jarrett and stuff like that. So the Four Horsemen get, or even though it's not four, but the Four Horsemen group gets the win. And so, yeah, that stops the match. And so, as they're walking back up, Mean Gene standing at the entrance, and he brings out Ric Flair, and then Chris Benoit and stuff out for a Four Horsemen like interview type thing, and Ric Flair saying that he's concerned with the condition of the Four Horsemen because back in the old days, as long as he had Arn Anderson and the other guys with him, they never had to worry about anything, and that it was more important that they get their deal done in the ring first and then worry about the women later, where currently they're worrying about the women first and then and not the in-ring stuff. And then they start to walk out, and Deborah gets on the mic with Gene and says that women, or makes a comment about making fun of women's hips and stuff like that. So very low petty women's stuff going on there. And then we have an NWO commercial with I don't know if this is like the only time they did it or whatever, but I would say it's like the classic NWO commercial they show with Eric Bischoff sitting on the motorcycle. Of course, he does It's Good to Be King thing. It's not the in-ring one that he does where the bike's lowered from the ceiling later on, but this is like their actual commercial thing. But he's like talking about, of course, as I said, says the thing with It's Good to Be King, talks about how Hulk Hogan has beat all the legends in the wrestling business and stuff, and so he's the best guy. And then, of course, you see Miss Elizabeth in the background holding a camera, and Eric keeps like harassing or like harassing her or whatever kind of stuff. And she even asks her a question about Macho Man stuff, and you can see she looks uncomfortable about it. Because at this point, I believe they're divorced or they're split up and stuff at least, so they're no longer together at this point in time. So then we have match number five, which is Dean Malenko versus the Ultimate Dragon with Sonny Ono, and it's just a pretty simple, quick match with Ultimate Dragon winning, or yeah, Ultimate Dragon winning, and he's the cruiserweight champion, I believe, at this time. I know he has a title, but I can't remember which one it is that they have. And so that's it for hour or the first hour. So we're gonna move on to hour number two, but I'm gonna take a break real quick. Okay, so now we're in hour number two, and we start off with a match of Lord Steven Regal versus Jacques Rougeau of the Amazing French Canadians. Of course, he has Colonel Parker with him. So again, it's again another match that like I'm not gonna go through every move, but Colonel Parker's interfering, and so he's like reaching into the ring. Well, William Regal stomps on his hand, so he starts flipping out, and so he gets up in the ring, and he goes to he has like this little stick. I don't know what kind of stick it is, but I would say it's kind of like a jockey stick almost. But he always carries it around. But he goes to hit William Regal with it, but of course William Regal moves and he ends up hitting Jacques instead, and so William Regal wins by disqualification. So that's the end of that match. And then we of course have again our commercial with Lee Marshall where he's in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Again, getting ready for the Nitro of next week. Again, talking about, of course, like cheese and stuff like that, and what seemed like very German type stuff because they talked about kielbasa and stuff like that, like sausages and everything. So again, telling about the Milwaukee like stereotype or culture and stuff like that. And then we have our match number seven, which is probably the most interesting thing that happened on this show, and some funny things kind of happened. So the match is Kevin Sullivan with Jimmy Hart against Chris Benoit. Again, Chris Benoit and Kevin Sullivan have problems because Chris Benoit is with woman, which is Nancy Sullivan, Kevin Sullivan's ex-wife. So there's some real kind of bad blood there. I've heard some stuff about this. I've heard that they were able to, be professional about it and stuff. But as Kevin Sullivan's walking out, Benoit runs down the ramp and stuff and attacks Kevin Sullivan from behind. And even Bro made a comment that it looked like that was real and stuff because of how hard he hit him and how he fell and stuff. So there could have been actual some vengeance going on here. And so they immediately, so they start in the entrance ramp, and so they immediately go out into the crowd. They go up the stairs. Again, through the crowd and stuff, and through the like little entrance into the arena part. So they're up in now what is like the hallways and stuff that, where they have concession stands and all that sort of stuff, in the arenas. And so they're fighting through there, and they end up going into a bathroom. And so they're fighting around the bathroom, and like Kevin Sullivan like tries to put Chris Benoit on the toilet and everything, and then Chris Benoit rips a picture off the wall and hits Kevin with it. And so they do all that and start to leave. Well, as they get outside the bathroom, of course, people know that this is going on by now, so the hallway is crowded with people, and so the only way they can get through is they're like pushed up against the wall right outside the bathroom. And security, of course, is trying to push people back, but they're not able to do it real well. So they're trying to like push their way and fight through this crowd and stuff. And they end up making it back to the arena. But of course, before they get into the actual arena, you see like woman, like the cameras are right behind her, and she has her shoes off, and she's like hitting people with the heels of her shoes and stuff, trying to get people away and everything. And she's yelling and screaming, but. So you go back into the arena, and so they're walking down the stairs now. Well, from the one camera view, you just see this guy, and he's like in an all, I don't know if he's in like a suit or something, or like a dress shirt type thing, but he's in red. And they're walking down, and he just like lunges forward at Kevin Sullivan. Like I said, but I don't know if like someone you thought would be funny and they pushed him into him, or if he just jumped at him and attacked him and stuff. So Kevin Sullivan, I believe, gets a few hits on the guy and stuff, and of course security jumps on him and everything. But so Kevin and Chris Benoit like go back down to the arena. Then they fight to the ring again. So they get back in the ring, and the actual match starts. And so this whole time, of course, it's very violent and aggressive. I think Kevin Sullivan has some blood on his head, but it's not like a lot. It's just you can just see a little tiny bit. And woman gets on the up on the apron for some reason, and she's distracting the referee. And so while she's doing that, Jimmy Hart grabs a ring bell from under the ring and hands it to Kevin Sullivan, who is knocked out. And Chris Benoit goes up to do his famous head diving headbutt finisher and stuff. And so as he jumps, Kevin Sullivan moves the ring bell in front, and so Chris Benoit's head hits the ring bell and stuff. And so Chris Benoit gets knocked out, and so Sullivan gets the win because, of course, Benoit is knocked out and stuff and can't move or fight or anything like that, so he gets the pin over him. So that was a very, like I said, violent and strong match type thing going on there, but it seemed very real, and so that's the good parts about wrestling is when it does seem real and you don't know if it's real or fake, that's when the stuff's very interesting. Then, of course, we have an NWO coming out, taking over commentary. Then we have Carl, I don't know how to say his name, Carl Ouellette or something like that. He's the other amazing French Canadian. He's the one with the eye patch. And then you have Colonel Parker again with him, and he faces off against Hacksaw. Throughout the match, Jacques ends up coming out, of course, his tag team partner, to interfere. And then, the Steiner brothers come out to take care of Jacques and stuff like that. And so there's a whole like inner distraction type thing and stuff. And then Hacksaw ends up winning with his tape fist, which he's been doing that for the past couple weeks. So pull like a roll of tape out of his pants and start wrapping his hands up. And then he's like sitting there like swinging. And of course the roll's like flying around his hand as he's just going like this. And so he just gets his hand all taped up, and then he just punches him. And for some reason the tape, oops, sorry. The tape on the hand knocks the guy out and stuff like that. So that is that. Then we have a review of the NWO feud with the DDP. Again, him not accepting the NWO offer to join him and stuff like that. Then we go to match 9 of Squire Dave Taylor, which again goes with like William Regal and stuff, and is a famous British wrestler and stuff. And he has a match against the new NWO member from New Japan of Mashiro Chono. And of course, for this, they send Nick Patrick, which is the famous NWO referee who was on like the NWO payroll and stuff. Excuse me. And so he's, of course, like paid to help the NWO win and stuff like that. And so through the match, Chono ends up winning with a submission on Dave Taylor. Then we have match 10, which is Booker T with, of course, with Sister Sherry versus Scott Hall. And again, Nick Patrick's the ref for the rest of these matches. And so throughout the match, Buff Bagwell for some reason comes running out to the ring, and he's like gets in Sister Sh Sherry's face and is just like talking to her and like pointing towards the back and stuff, but they never like do anything, or she, you know, don't run off like something happened in the back or anything. So I don't know what that's all about, but Scott Hall ends up getting the win with the Outsider's Edge instead of the Razor's Edge, of course, with him being in front of the Outsiders. So there's that match, then we have match our last ma actual match of the night, but it's Stevie Ray again with Sherry versus Lex Luger with Nick Patrick on as referee again. And Lex ends up getting the win with the torture rack, which is just a which this time it's a really bad torture rack. Like he's got Stevie Ray up on his shoulders, and he's just like shaking himself. Like he's not like Stevie Ray's not even moving, so you can tell the crappiness of the move. And so Lex wins with that. And then we have our final segment in the show, which is Hulk Hogan, of course, coming out with Ted DiBiase and Vincent, because they're the only two or the only people that weren't out at the commentary table. And so they come out to the ring, and of course Hulk Hogan's on the mic just talking crap about the Giant and stuff like that. And then the Giant ends up walking out towards the ring and stuff, but is stopped by security and everything. And he's just trying to work his way to the ring and stuff, and has like a look like he's possibly crying stuff, like he may be offended, which if you know Big Show, which is the Giant of current days, he likes to cry a lot and stuff. So forget what it was, but anyways, I know Bro made a comment about him crying and stuff like that, so it's kind of funny, but that's just how it ends. Like Giant's trying to get into the ring as the it cuts out to black or whatever for the end of the show. So that is it for January 20th, 1997, Raw and Nitro. Of course, you can again, as I keep saying, since Raw is only 1 hour, you see the mass amounts of matches that Nitro has compared to it. Where Raw, they have the formula of just having three matches throughout the night. So you can like see the difference and judge which one you think wins the show. Of course, again, at this time, if you didn't know, Nitro's winning every week, I believe up until sometime in 98. They're winning all the time and stuff. So that's it for the two Raws. So if you enjoyed, please leave a thumbs up. Leave any comments you have down below. Let me know which one you thought was better, whether it be Raw or Nitro, or which one just in general besides this episode you liked more and stuff as a kid or growing up, whatever age you were and stuff and are seeing this. Subscribe to see more, and we will see you next time.